Wolves, once hunted to near extinction, now roam the forests. Birds, once scarce, fly high in the sky. Hidden secrets can be discovered in the ocean depths. Even bears can be found, high up in the mountain ranges. This is a country of extreme landscapes and dramatic backdrops. There's a whole array of diverse, unusual, and stunning wildlife. In an ancient wilderness that is being rediscovered. This is one of our closest neighbors, France. We may be familiar with its fine wine, haute cuisine, and rural beauty. But there is another side of this land that may surprise. This is the wild side of France. France is more than twice the size of the UK, but with a similar population, it has far greater expanses of wilderness. Parts of this wilderness are being returned to how they once were, with the reintroduction of some iconic species. This film will give an impression of France's wild side. Once, many years ago, brown bears would have existed across the whole of France. Just imagine the sight of this magnificent creature roaming across the land. They were once a hunter's prized trophy, and by the 1930s, these fearsome bears had all but gone from the French forests. But in recent years, a small number of brown bears have been reintroduced to the Pyrenees in the south of France. Bears need a seasonal abundance of high-energy foods. They will eat insects, berries, plants, and fish. Naturalists would like to reintroduce more of these top predators. They believe it would bring a more natural balance back to the French countryside. Across the whole of France, there is a great variety of wildlife, some of which may surprise. We journey from the Pyrenees to the far east of France, to a famous mountain range, the Alps. Well known for its ski resorts and stunning scenery, there is also plenty of space for wildlife. This is Écrins National Park. Its high mountain summits form a dramatic skyline full of snowy glaciers. From the top of these, water floods down, forming icy, fast-flowing rivers. Within the lower torrents is a small bird with unique abilities. The dipper feeds on insect larvae that live in the riverbeds. Despite the freezing temperatures, it dives deep into the glacial water. Using its wings to swim, it can reach depths of 2 meters and remain there for up to 15 seconds. It will do this several times a day in order to feed its young. Moving up to the high-altitude pastures of these mountains, there is an animal that lives below ground in a deep system of underground burrows. These are alpine marmots. They come up to the surface to play, mate, and to feed. They're social creatures and live in small family groups. Alpine marmots used to be widely hunted, due to the belief that their fat would ease rheumatism when rubbed on the skin. In some areas of France, they've been successfully introduced and are a common sight. Marmots are highly defensive animals and have developed a kind of collective surveillance system. Sentinels take turns to guard their territory. With a range of different calls, they can warn others of any potential danger. A short single whistle sees everyone take cover. And there's good reason. The legendary Golden Eagle. The eagle's eyesight is far superior to ours. The marmot's warning system has to be good, as it is indeed a fearsome predator. Eagles have existed here for hundreds of thousands of years, far longer than any human settlers. They have built their homes in the highest parts of the mountains. To protect their nests, they can be fiercely territorial. If another eagle gets too close, they will fight, sometimes to the death. The eagle rules the skies, but they're not alone at the summit. Amazingly, these chamois thrive on a vertical existence. And there are other animals that have managed to carve out a life in such seemingly inaccessible clifftops. Further south, in the peaks of the Verdon Canyon, a small creature can be found that seems to almost defy the laws of gravity. The wall creeper, known locally as the butterfly bird. Arnaud Petit and Stephanie Baudet share a passion with this small bird for terrifying heights. They're leading European climbers. They brave the sheer and frightening cliff faces to catch a glimpse of these delicate birds. The butterfly bird has large feet with solid curved claws, which enable it to stand with perfect balance. It gets its name because of the way it scales the cliffs by fluttering its colorful wings. Its wide wings enable it to take advantage of the rising currents and effortlessly reach great heights. More effort is required by the climbers, and occasionally their balance is not quite as perfect. Arnaud and Stephanie share the nesting choice of the butterfly bird. They pitch their portal edge into the side of the cliff, high above the huge emptiness below. Sleeping at such a great height is like being suspended momentarily out of time. Far below the mountaintops, it's the depths of the forest that can be a frightening place for some. It's early spring, and these two wolf cubs are just 3 weeks old. It's the first time they've ventured out of their dark den to see their surroundings. They'll need to learn who is friend and who is foe in their forest home. As daylight comes, there is a whole new world above their den to explore. Their mother returns to check on them. The pups are cared for by all members of the pack, but the mother is the dominant figure. Wolves were hunted almost to extinction in France in the 1930s. Now, as a protected species, their numbers are growing. By winter, the small cubs will be almost fully grown and ready to travel with the pack. Further north, and past the Alps, there is another mountain chain which borders Germany, the Vosges Mountains. Across these, geese can be seen in the autumn, as they make their way to southern climes to spend the winter. For thousands of years, the adults have been guiding their young along these airborne routes. Geese have a remarkable homing instinct, allowing them to return to the same area year after year, even when their migration takes them halfway around the world. The youngsters in the family group follow their parents, taking advantage of the current, and flying as if part of a platoon. The young will stay with their parents until the next breeding season. They have an innate knowledge of the direction and distance they should travel, but not necessarily where they should be aiming for. So following their parents for their first migration means they will reach their winter breeding ground. Adult geese will use visual references, including rivers and mountains, to guide themselves. They stop at night to rest in marshlands, by rivers or by lakes. Come dawn, they'll have to wait for the fog to lift before taking to the air again. When the sun's rays are strong enough to create rising winds, they will set off, knowing that they can now be carried along. En route to their winter home, geese can cover up to 300 kilometers in just one day. By next year, the youngsters will be able to take this journey alone. We travel now across the country to the north of France, to a very special place not far from Paris. Here lies one of the largest forests in the country, covering more than 50,000 acres. This is the forest of Fontainebleau. This legendary ancient forest has been the playground of kings for centuries. There is a proud history of deer hunting in France. Generations have driven hounds through this forest. Their dogs have scoured the thick undergrowth and rocky outcrops hundreds of times, hoping to catch a scent of prey. Forest of Fontainebleau, full of oaks, pine, and beech trees, is home to a huge variety of animals. One of those is the red deer. These two 10-pointer stags are 7 years old and have been together all their lives. It's not uncommon for stags to form partnerships, but these particular two have become almost inseparable. They work as allies, warning each other of danger and sharing food, such as tender ivy or willow leaves. In the hot weather, they will linger in water to keep cool and get rid of annoying midges. It's rare for these two males to be out of each other's sight. They know their territory very well and have a network of trails to follow. This comes in useful should they need to escape from hunting dogs. There are hundreds of red deer in Fontainebleau. They have no natural predators, so are fair game for hunters. When they sense danger, they will flee as quickly as possible. Their long legs give them an advantage as they plunge into the river water and out of sight. The water also helps to dilute their scent, which dogs can trace for hours. These two stags will spend the winter, spring, and summer together. But when autumn arrives, it's a different story. antlers have lost their velvet texture. Their coats have grown and darkened. They're now full of testosterone and can think only of one thing, the female deer, or hinds. They mingle with the hinds to get their scent. In turn, their calls excite the females and help to stimulate their ovulation. From this moment, there will be no more sharing between the males. There can only be one winner. This is a battle without compromise. It will only end when one of the males backs down and surrenders. The hinds can only watch and wait. Finally, the cry of victory. The females gather around their triumphant hero. The champion will stay with his harem for about a month, fighting off any male who tries to enter his territory. But then, when the mating season is over, all will change once again. Battles will be forgotten, and the two stags of Fontainebleau will once again become close allies. Our journey now takes us to the west of France. Near the Atlantic Sea is the region of Poitou-Charentes. It's home to one of the largest wetlands in France, known as the Poitain Marshes. Here, seawater meets freshwater. In this unusual habitat, the wildlife flourishes. And in the spring, it is teeming with new life. There's one creature here who has to undergo an incredible transformation. The dragonfly. This small larva has spent more than a year under the water. Tonight, it will undergo an amazing metamorphosis. It appears to almost inflate its new body so that it can break out of its old skin. Its new feet emerge, but the dragonfly can't use them yet as they're still too soft. It must wait for them to harden. In this position, it's vulnerable. Falling now would be certain death. Not far from the dragonfly's precarious perch, another new birth is about to happen. These are greater horseshoe bats, a protected species across Europe. The bats will often roost in old disused buildings in the late spring and summer, going out after sunset to hunt and feed. This is a maternity roost, and it's time for the new babies to be born. For this female, the contractions have begun. The head appears first. The mother begins by cleaning her newborn, She licks it and frees its ears, which were stuck to its head. Once the baby is free, it begins to suckle and will do so for the first month of its life. The mother wraps her wings around her precious bundle, protecting it from any danger. Back on the moonlit water, the dragonfly's feet are at last hard enough. Finally, it can leave its former body. Now the miracle can happen. Its soft and intricate wings unfurl gradually. Early morning has arrived, and the transformation is complete. Four independent wings on a perfectly aerodynamic body. The small larva that came out of the water last night has become one of the most sophisticated flying creatures in the world. Soon it will find a partner, and the cycle will begin again. The Poitevin Marshes is a fascinating area. It was once completely covered with wetland, full of insects. Around the 10th century, monks started the process of drying up the swamps. They built dams to stop the water rising, and dug canals to evacuate rainwater, and to free up the fertile soil. The land could then be used for agriculture, but some areas were left untouched. Many species of birds come to nest here. Within this area is a dense hidden forest, which serves as a nursery for a colony of herons. These fledglings are 3 weeks old and are constantly hungry. One of the three youngsters stands back, while the other two devour everything their mother regurgitates. Usually both parents will help feed the offspring, but here the male has disappeared, so the mother has to work twice as hard to feed her young. She'll fly up to 30 kilometers hunting for food in the swamps, and competition can be fierce. Competition within the nest is also fierce. The two strongest chicks have united against the weakest and smallest. More frail and less active, he can only eat the leftovers. The problem is, there aren't any. A single parent cannot possibly feed all three. Instinctively, they attack their little brother in what is a struggle for survival. The weakest of the three will die, so that the other two can live. The laws of nature can often seem cruel. Moving back down to the south of France, there is an area known as the Cévennes. a maze of mountains, deep valleys, and winding rivers. The river water descending from the granite mountains has carved out the distinctive contours of this stunning area. Over time, the water has dug out canyons hundreds of meters deep. In the cliffs of these spectacular canyons, there is an extraordinary animal, the griffon vulture. Until recent years, vultures had almost completely disappeared. Successful reintroduction programs have dramatically increased the number of these formidable birds. Vultures live in colonies, and they work together to scavenge for food. It's 6 in the morning, and the sun hasn't yet penetrated the depths of the canyons. Without the warmth of the sun, the vultures do not fly. In spite of hunger, there's no question of moving yet. At last, the air can carry them. Like an air squadron, dozens of vultures fill the sky. The warm currents help them gain height. As part of their scavenging strategy, they divide up the territory. The large birds fly over several kilometers, scanning every inch of their land, but never losing sight of the other vultures. If one of them spots something, it immediately dives down. The other vultures haven't seen it, but they've noticed the absence of one of them. This means there's something to eat down below. In a matter of seconds, the entire colony gather around for the feast. The work of one benefits all. Sharing is the price to pay for the colony's survival. Each bird can now return to its nest with a share of the spoils for its youngsters. The return of these imposing birds across this region is widely celebrated. Vultures eat rotting carcasses, helping to prevent the spread of disease, cleansing the wilderness. To the north of the Cevennes mountain range is a region called the Lozère. With its high plateaus, it's famous for its dramatic scenery and numerous pretty villages. The source of many rivers can be found here, the most famous of which is the River Tarn. In the spring, the Tarn is at its most powerful, with exciting, fast-flowing torrents. Within this river is a creature which is beginning to make a comeback in France. The otter. With its streamlined body, the otter is a skillful predator. It has powerful webbed feet and whiskers which help it detect the slightest movement of any underwater prey. The otter's habitat stretches over 40 kilometers of river. Otters are a threatened species across Europe, but with the help of protection laws and water quality improvement, there is evidence that its numbers are gradually recovering. As a hunter, the otter is fearsome. Everyone goes into hiding. If a fish sees an otter, it's already too late. In this river, the otter reigns supreme. The mountains of the Lozère are home to an insect which is unique to this area, a black bee. It's only thanks to intensive conservation efforts that the pure breed of this bee can still be found here. This flower-loving insect is a workaholic. Its short life is dedicated to the good of the hive and the production of honey. Yves Elie is an expert beekeeper. He spent years helping to protect the bees of this region. He follows in a long-standing tradition of this area. To house his bees, Eve builds them traditional trunk hives, which are similar to their natural habitat. In these chestnut tree trunks, thousands of workers live around their queen. They feed and groom each other. In the process, they pass on pheromones, chemical signals, which reveal information about the health of their queen and the state of the colony. Chemical signals also help with foraging. Honeybees use scent to locate flowers from a distance. When a successful forager returns to the hive, it passes the scent of the flowers to its nestmates to help them find the same patch of flowers. Through a series of dances, it indicates the direction, distance, and even the quantity of pollen available. To help conserve the black honeybee, Eve attempts to create a new swarm every year. It's a skillful operation. He coaxes the queen bee into entering the trap just above the hive. Almost immediately after she's left the hive, a new queen bee will take over. To avoid inbreeding and preserve the species, Eve takes the old queen to a faraway site where there are no other species of bee. During its life, the bee will have to fulfill several roles: cleaner, nursemaid, builder, before they are finally promoted to nectar gatherer. Then, after only 30 days, it will fall to the ground, struck down by exhaustion. During its short life, a bee can produce several grams of honey. Eve is hopeful that these colonies will continue to produce honey for many years to come. 170 kilometers off the southeastern coast of France, in the Mediterranean Sea, lies the island of Corsica. Two-thirds of this majestic island is made up of mountains, which form a single chain along its entire length. Famous for its high red cliffs, sandy beaches and headlands, this is the Scandola Reserve. Scandola is one of the oldest reserves in France and a UNESCO World Heritage Site. As a protected site, It's home to some stunning and rare wildlife, including osprey. The sea conceals another extraordinary landscape. Jean-Marie Dominici is the curator of this site and has spent his life protecting the wildlife here. Teeming with life, the waters are home to a whole variety of fish, some quite rare. It's a diver's paradise. As well as fish, the reserve is full of unusual plant life, seaweed and coral. Scandola Reserve is one of the Mediterranean's most important ecosystems, an extensive and extraordinary underwater prairie. It's a favorite spot for many fish species to spawn their eggs. The eggs laid here are carried by the current outside the limits of the reserve and help nurture all the neighboring marine sites. There is one particular and strange-looking fish that fascinates Jean-Marie. The grouper. The grouper would normally live on the sea floor at depths of up to 300 meters. But here, in this protected area, it can be seen much closer to the surface. Jean-Marie is able to study it in close-up. The grouper is a hermaphrodite. It's born as a female, but by the age of 16, it changes sex to become a male. Males and females come together in the early summer to reproduce. As part of their courtship, the males change color as a means of seduction. The grouper almost disappeared from the Mediterranean coasts. But now, thanks to reserves like Scandola, it once again thrives. Close to the Scandola Reserve is a beach where fresh water joins the sea, the Fango Delta. In these natural ponds lives an animal that has existed for millions of years, the turtle. Although found in many different places, the European pond turtle is under threat from water pollution and habitat destruction, and its numbers have been declining. Here, though, it appears to be flourishing. As a cold-blooded reptile, it needs the sun's rays for energy. During the day, it will bask on the shore or on rocks. But this shy species will dive back into water if disturbed. Underwater, it will hunt for fish, insects, or mollusks. It's the mating season, and the courtship technique of the turtle is a curious one. The male approaches the female suddenly, pinning her in place as he bites her face and neck as they mate. If not careful, the technique can inflict serious injuries on the female. It's a brutal affair, but necessary in order to continue the line. Moving inland, towards the center of Corsica, the terrain is full of dense, thorny bushes. To survive in this prickly environment, you need a very thick skin. The king of this terrain is the wild boar. Most wild boars live in close-knit groups of around 20. They mainly consist of females and their young. Females will normally have between 4 and 8 babies, and they are very protective of them. Boars are scavengers and eat almost anything they come across, including grass, nuts, roots, even small reptiles. Older males do not usually stay in the group. They lead a largely solitary life. To keep cool, they will roll in mud. Covering their body in a thick layer also helps get rid of irritating ticks. During the mating season, large solitary males will travel across the countryside in search of female groups. They're capable of covering several kilometers of varied terrain every day. This breeding strategy helps to maintain a strong population, not just here on the island of Corsica, but across the whole of France. The wild side of France is extensive and can be extraordinary. There is rural beauty, where time seems to have stood still. Alongside this is a rugged wilderness which can push nature to the limit. Here, formidable birds soar above the mountains. Wolves have made their home in the forests. And even bears can be seen in their natural habitat. From coastline to mountaintop, France is a country of extreme and surprising beauty, with wildlife that never ceases to feed our imagination.